I suppose we have some games.
Hey guys, welcome back to Classic G-Body Garage. I got the hood up on this 79 Malibu 4-speed, and the reason for that is this car does not run very good. If you guys saw at the beginning of the video how terrible it runs, if you give it the slightest amount of gas like you saw me doing there, it just bogs out and flat out stalls. So what this video is going to be about is rebuilding your typical 4-barrel Quadrajet. Now, same thing goes with the 2-barrels, the dual jets. Right there, cut the carburetor right in half, get rid of the rear 2 barrels, and then you got yourself a dual jet. So Quadrajets and dual jets, same exact carburetor for the most part, and very easy to rebuild. I know a lot of people don't like these carburetors. I'm really not sure why, just because they're a great all-around carb. They can be tweaked, tuned to run on drag cars, anything like that. They have a good large CFM. And really, like I said, not all that bad to rebuild. So I'm gonna show you guys exactly what to do as far as rebuilding one of these. And obviously the first thing to do is go ahead and get it off of the car. All right, it's off. Mouse nest. All right guys, I got the carburetor off the Malibu sitting here on the workbench, and I also got myself a brand new carb kit. And I went through carbkitsource.com. You know, getting carburetor kits anymore through regular auto parts stores is kind of a job, just because cars don't use carburetors anymore. And grabbing a carb kit from any old auto parts store, chances are you might not even get the right one. So I went ahead and looked at the carb numbers online and researched which kit to get. And this place gave me a deal just because I bought so many kits, just because I have 2 carbs sitting here and I have several more in the basement and what else, you know, I have going on with these other cars. So now, in order to get a kit for these things, you have to get the correct carburetor part number. Now, in order to find that, on all Quadrajets, they are located right on the side, right underneath the driver's side secondary. And there are 2 sets of numbers here on the side. I'm not sure if this camera will focus in on the numbers there, but there are 2 sets of numbers, and you're gonna wanna look for the 170 number. That's usually the case. Got a carburetor right here. This one you can see a little bit better. See if I can focus in on this one, but this one you can see real clear. There you go. It's a 170-33. I'm sorry, 170-83224. So do what you can to clean off the carburetor and get the correct number, and that'll get you the correct kit. So a couple of other things before you take these things apart. You know, just make sure everything's there before you go and start tearing it all apart. I got 2 of them sitting right here. Actually, let me grab the other one because I want to show you guys something. Over time, the government started mandating that all of the adjustments on these carburetors get all set from the factory and capped off. Now, what happens over time, people rebuild these carburetors and they go ahead and knock the caps off of the carburetor so you can get to the mixture screws. And the idle mixture screws are located at the base of the carburetor. There's one on the driver's side and then one hidden on the passenger side. Now, if it is plugged up, if it is plugged off, let me wipe that off right here. This is not an adjustment screw, but this is pretty much what a plugged off adjustment screw looks like. Basically just an aluminum plug over top of the screw itself. And on this one here, the carburetor off of the Malibu, someone has popped the caps off of it. Basically what you do is you take a grinder or a hacksaw and you slice into the body of the carburetor or the base plate of the carburetor. It's just aluminum, and you make some slices, and then you can get like a center punch and tap the cap out of the way, and then you got yourself an auto mixture screw right there. And the head of the screw looks like just a regular hex head on both sides there. And then this is a slightly older carburetor. I believe it's a 77, right around 78 or 79. They started plugging these things off, and there you go. That is what an exposed idle mixture screw looks like. And you can see right on the tip there, it has a regular standard flathead screw. Easy to get to. And then finally on this carburetor sitting over here, yet another way to see what it looks like. And that has a reverse flathead. And they do make carburetor adjustment tools that you can buy at the auto parts store to get to those oddball mixture screws just like that. So easy to get to. But that's also another indication that you can tell if a carburetor's ever been rebuilt. If someone told you it's never been rebuilt, well, those caps most likely are still present. If the carburetor's been messed with over time, those caps have been busted off and the screws have been exposed. So, as you guys saw, this thing's pissing all over the place. As you guys saw, this car ran terribly, and I need to go ahead and tear this thing apart. It's stinking just sitting here. So I'm going to go ahead and start pulling this thing apart. And the first thing you got to do when pulling these carburetors apart is just start getting rid of all of the auxiliary stuff, you know, like the wing nut, the threaded rod here, which I'll have to get a pair of pliers to get that off of there. You go ahead and you pull all the diaphragms off. This one here, there's sometimes one on the back side here. And then you also have the air conditioning solenoid that goes right here. And someone has taken it off of this Malibu already. I'm not sure why they did that, but this carburetor here, I'll snag it off of this one. And then you can see on this one back here, this one has the secondary diaphragm right here. So some have just a secondary, some have just a primary. You know, it depends upon what car the carburetor was on. So once those are off, those are basically all the excess auxiliary items that you want to take off. And then next thing you do is start removing the accelerator pump arm. Remove that first, this roll pin. I'll show you how to do that here in a second. And then you go ahead and start removing all the screws that hold the air horn of the carburetor on. So put the camera down and I'll go ahead and start tearing this thing down. All right, to go ahead and remove this roll pin, I basically just take an old drill bit, just like that, and put it right there in the roll pin. And just go ahead and tap it. Bring the roll pin just about right before it hits the choke area right there. And it basically comes loose. Take it off just like that. Set it aside. Leave the roll pin in there. The kit comes with a new one if you do want to replace it, but they really don't wear out, so there's really no need to replace the roll pin. Now, next thing you do is you go ahead and remove all the screws. Now, all the screws that hold on the air horn right here, you have one in the front here. There's two of them. It's kind of dark. There you go, down inside the primaries. One right there and one on the other side. Then there's two more on the back side of this plate right here. Right there, right there. And you have two in the back, one there, and then two on the sides here and here. All right, I went ahead and removed the diaphragm right there. And one other thing you do need to move, which I forgot to tell you guys, is the choke rod right there, the little lever that operates the choke. So you gotta pull out that flathead screw, and then the rod will just kind of sit there once you pull that out of place, once you pull the air horn off. So go ahead and remove that screw. As far as rebuilding these carburetors, there's really no reason to remove the choke plate or the secondary butterflies. All these screws, you can keep those in their place. And one other screw, there you go, there's another one I forgot to tell you guys about. This one right here, these are the secondary metering rods. Go ahead and pull that out. Very, very small screw, so be careful you don't break any of these screws. Take that screw out on the secondary rods, lift out of place. Just like that. Set those aside, just kind of set them down gently. You don't want to bend them. You'll unscrew the wing nut stud. There you go. Now I have everything out of the way
as far as all the auxiliary stuff. And set everything aside just so you don't lose it. So I'm gonna go ahead and quickly remove all these screws. Now some of these screws are longer than the others, but just two of them, which are just these back two right here. The front ones that go in the primaries, they're just a flathead screw, so those are not hard to screw up. And I'll show you the two different length screws. These back ones are the only two that are longer than all the rest. There you go, noticeably longer, so you can't really screw them up. Moby, what's up? Hey, all right, now when pulling the air horn off of one of these carburetors, let me get the choke rod out of here, if I can get it off. Or we're just sitting there. There we go, it kind of just hooks down inside of there. Make the air horn a little bit easier to take off. Now these air horns tend to get stuck. Now you don't want to stick a screwdriver in here and start prying, because you're gonna mess up the seat or the flat area where the gasket sits. So basically what you want to do is just, if it doesn't pull off, let's see if this one even pulls off. There, this one just comes loose very, very easily. Just take a hammer and just kind of lightly tap around it, and then it'll break it free. So let me go ahead and grab the camera, and we'll see what this thing looks like. But these just basically lift off very, very easily. And there you go. Now sometimes those tubes, there are four tubes sitting there, sometimes those things fall off and they'll be sitting down inside those holes right there. So all you do is just put them back on and gently tap them back into place. Maybe take a piece of wood or a piece of plastic, set it on top, and just lightly tap it inside there. You don't want to pound them back in, by all means. So this is what a Quadrajet looks like as soon as you pull the air horn off. This is the power valve. Make sure that moves freely, spring loaded. And then this is the accelerator pump. Overall, this thing looks pretty good. It is filled with gas, so I'm gonna pull off the gasket here and dump this old gas out of here. So before I do that, now this power valve kind of sits in here. It's kind of pressed into place. It's got like a plastic washer that holds it into place. So they do get kind of stuck in there. So you can either tear the gasket, which I'm gonna do to remove it, or you can, if it lifts out of place, you can do that as well. So let me go ahead and set the camera down again. We'll get this gasket off of here. Just kind of work the gasket around the pump right there. All right, so there's the gasket. Just kind of set that aside. All right, so I'm gonna pull this pump out of here very gently. Just kind of pulls out of place. Set that aside. Pull the accelerator pump out, which is right here. And I know that this thing had some serious problems with bogging out. The accelerator pump is really not that hard. It's a piece of plastic that goes over top of the float, kind of the float hold down. So that just lifts out of place. You got a spring right here for the accelerator pump that's pressed into place. Sometimes that wants to come out easily, sometimes it doesn't. This one does not, so I think I'll just kind of keep that in there for now. I might grab a hook and pull it out. Now here's the float sitting in here, and you can see how discolored the gas is. So here's the float. You gotta make sure it moves up and down nice and freely. Nothing's stuck. Everything so far looks pretty good, and that just simply pulls out of place. Oh, and before you do that, make note of how the needle is hooked into place. The needle does not hook through one of those holes. It hooks around the hole. So make sure you pay close attention to that, and then which direction, pending the last person put it together correctly, is located. So that pulls out of place. There's the needle. Set that down as well. And there we go. I have to grab my flashlight. There it is. See what this thing looks like inside. And you can see it is plenty gunked up. It has all sorts of things going on inside there. Looks like it's got some thick sediment inside the carburetor. Let me grab a screwdriver. Gently, oh yeah, it's got some real thick sediment. Don't scrape the bottom because these carburetors are plated, but I just wanted to see what kind of crap come out of the bottom of this. And there you go. That's not a good sign. I don't know if that's rust from inside of the gas tank, which I doubt it is. I think it's just dirt from sitting over time and just years of being in the Arizona desert. But that's what's on the bottom of this carburetor, and that's a good reason why this thing's not running the way it should. Just because, if you could see, right there and right there, those are the jets for this car. And I'm surprised this thing even ran, because those jets are nearly plugged up. So once I get everything all cleaned up in here, you'll be able to see exactly what I'm talking about. But so far, we're looking pretty sad as far as a gunked up carburetor. This is probably one of the worst I've seen. So I'm hoping the inside of the gas tank doesn't look this bad, because I'm hesitant to pull it out of the car right now. But I'm going to stick a hose inside the gas tank and pull it back out and see if I get any gunk on that hose. But if I do, then I'll pull the tank. Otherwise, I'm just going to go ahead and pump it out. But I'm going to go ahead and finish taking this thing apart. This little cup pulls out of here. Let me just dump that in there. This gas is bright orange. Pretty nasty stuff here. See if you guys can get a good shot of this. Wow. The inside of this carburetor is just absolutely caked. All right, now you guys can see a little bit better what I'm working on and what I'm looking at. This thing is pretty nasty. So what I'm gonna do is, like I said, finish pulling this thing apart. I'll pull the base off here. Comes off just as easy as the top. But I wanted to show you guys, I'm surprised this car really even ran, but it did run pretty poorly. In order to pull the base plate off, you don't have to mess with anything else, because you know, you think, okay, how do I do this? Do I have to take all this linkage off of here? Do I have to take the choke off of here? Well, in reality, you don't have to do any of that. All you do is flip it upside down, and the base plate is held on by three Phillips screws, and that is it. And what happens a lot of times with these Quadrajets is these screws work themselves loose, and the base plate becomes loose, and then you get a vacuum leak right at the base of this carburetor. But these are still nice and tight. Definitely don't forget to tighten these up when you rebuild the carburetor, or you'll have yourself a nice vacuum leak and wondering why your car doesn't run very good. Base plate is loose. Let's see if it comes off of here. There we go. Base plate just lifts off just as easily as the air horn does. All the linkage comes with it. There's the accelerator pump rod right there. There you go. So you go ahead and set that aside, find a place for that temporarily. And then you, here's the gasket, and that just pulls out of place. There you go. All right, now, another thing that happens to these Quadrajets over time there's a spring right there. That is for the power valve that fell out when I dumped it upside down. All right, these plugs right here, There's one here, two plugs here, two plugs here. These are underneath the float bowl, and these are basically lead plugs that are pounded into the casting of the carburetor. What happens over time is these plugs start to leak. Now, if you ever had a problem with your car sitting for a week or so at a time, it's really, really hard to start. That's because what happens is the fuel leaks out of the fuel bowl through these plugs, and then your fuel bowl is empty, and that's why it's hard to start, because the fuel pump has to pump gas back into the carburetor, and that's why it cranks and cranks and cranks. So a trick to do is either tap these plugs back down a little tighter with the hammer, or put some JB Weld over top of these plugs, or anything that isn't dissolved by gas, and to reseal these plugs back up. And then your car will be a whole lot easier starting over time when it rivets. So I'm gonna go ahead and remove these. You might wanna take note before you remove it, where the choke is set. There's some dashes right here, and then there's a line on this piece of plastic housing, and you can take note of where the line is mashed up with the dashes. All right, once the choke is loose, that lifts out of there. There's a gasket on there. And then you have the spring-loaded choke, which is a heated spring, works off of the heat of the engine. And then there's two screws in here. The center screw, you don't have to mess with. The top screw is what holds this housing onto the carburetor itself. Now, when you remove this housing, now you don't have to remove the housing, but there is a seal behind there, which I'm going to replace. Now, this part gets a little bit complicated because you have all the choke mechanism in here. So just pay attention to how it comes apart when you take it apart. Remove the screw and take it apart and just kind of hold it like this so everything comes with it. And then you have this little, basically this arm right here. And what this arm does is when the vehicle is cold, this arm is automatically engaged this way and prevents the secondaries from opening until the choke warms up, the car warms up, and then the arm moves this way in conjunction with all the choke, and that'll allow the secondaries to open, because you definitely don't want to be using the secondaries on a cold motor because it's just going to kill it. So I'm going to go ahead and remove this screw. There you go. It all comes with it. Set that down. That arm's still sitting there. Pay attention to how that arm went back on there and set that aside. And there you go. Full disassembly of a Quadrajet for the most part right there. Now, I did not get into removing the seat right here. There's a couple other odds and ends which I'll get to here in a second. But what I want to do before I remove anything else is take some carb cleaner and blast all this nasty shit out of here. All right, I got the carburetor all clean. Basically just cleaned it out with some standard carburetor cleaner. Took a toothpick and a popsicle stick and lightly scraped the bowl. You don't want to scrape it with a screwdriver because you're going to end up scraping the plating off of the carburetor itself, and you don't want to do that. So this was just an initial cleaning, just because there was so much sludge in the bottom of this carburetor that I did not want to let it dry up and get hard. So while it was all soft and slimy, I wanted to spray it out of there, dig it out of there gently, and clean it up the best I can, just to make my life a whole lot easier. So now you can see the two jets right here and then right there. Basically just take a Phillips or a flathead screwdriver and carefully remove those, place them aside, make note of which side they came out of, and then you're going to want to take a large flathead screwdriver, remove the needle seat, which is located right here, and then also another flathead screwdriver, and carefully remove that screw right there, and there is a check ball underneath that screw. So once you remove that screw, dump the carburetor upside down, and a little ball bearing will fall out of there. So make sure you take note of that as well. Now there is an adjustment right there, which is the power valve adjustment. Now, as long as the carburetor has never been apart, or at least the individual who had it apart knew what they were doing, you are not to adjust that screw. That basically sets the depth of how far the power valve goes up and down. Now, here's the power valve right here, and that sits down in that hole like that, and that pin right there sets on top of the flat part of that screw and bounces up and down. You saw the spring that came out of there. It bounces up and down on there. And that basically sets the depth on how far these needles go down into those two primary jets. So if you mess with that adjustment right there, the depth of that screw, you're gonna mess with the idle adjustment. And I did that one time and I learned the hard way. And basically the car would not idle down and it huffed smoke like you wouldn't believe. So black smoke, it was way too rich, running way too fast. So I had to find out the depth of that screw. The carburetor instructions do not come with that information. I will tell you that information here in just a bit because I did write it down. So got the general cleaning done. I'm gonna go ahead and remove all the rest of the screws and jets and things like that. Go ahead and spray this thing down, blow it off with the air compressor. Every little passage you can think of, spray it with carburetor cleaner and blow it out the best you can. Get all that black carbon out of there, get it all nice and shiny. Use a toothbrush, parts cleaning brush, whatever you can. Don't use a wire brush on it. Don't use anything harsh that's gonna ruin the plating on this carburetor. And then also underneath here, go ahead and remove this fitting. The filter, it says filter right there. Can't really read it, but it does have a filter, a paper filter. So go ahead and remove that, get that filter out of there, clean it all up, blow it all out with the air compressor, and I'm gonna go ahead and do that right now. All right, I went ahead and removed the two jets. You see right there, and I have them sitting right there on the workbench. And I mentioned that there was a ball bearing underneath this screw. So I'm gonna go ahead and take this out and you guys can see exactly what this screw looks like. And then also the ball bearing that comes out of there. If I can grab a hold of this thing. So that's what the screw looks like. Let me back out a little bit. It's not a mixture adjustment screw or anything like that. It's just basically a passageway screw. Just got a weird looking end on it. Set that aside. And I'll go ahead and dump this carb upside down. You can see the ball bearing sitting inside of there. Check ball. There it goes. There's a little check ball that fell out of there and the kit comes with a new one. It's not like these wear out, but at least you got a spare. All right, time to get this thing cleaned. Okay, I have the base plate here and you can see the idle screws here. And I showed you that these are hex head idle screws because the caps have been taken off. So I got myself a deep well, little tiny socket that'll fit over top of there. And before you go ahead and remove these screws, basically put the socket on there and count. Let me get it on here. Count how many turns it takes to run the screw all the way down until it stops, like you're tightening it. But do not over tighten it. If you over tighten these screws, you're liable to mess up the seat in here and also the screw as well. So go ahead and tighten it down. You don't even need a wrench. It's half a turn, one turn. So 6.5, which is actually a lot further than I thought it would be. So 6.5 on that side. And I'll go ahead and do the other side. Half, one, 4. So that side's 4 and this side's 6, which is much, much different. So very uneven. So when I put this back together, I'll go ahead and make sure that these are equally tuned. And this one being out 6 or 6.5, whatever I said, is actually way too far. They should be about 4 a piece. All right, let me remove one of these screws so you can see exactly what it looks like. They have a spring on them. And basically the screw just looks like a tip. It has a tip on it, just a needle tip. And like I said, if you screw it down too far, you're gonna either mash the tip, which you may not, actually you won't mash the tip because the tip protrudes through the venturi right here, but you're gonna leave a ridge on that screw and you're gonna go ahead and mess that up. So definitely don't wanna over tighten these screws, but that's exactly what it looks like. Thank you.
All right, guys, it took me several hours, but I finally have this gunked up carburetor good as new, nice and clean. You can see the inside of the float bowl. There isn't any of that sludge left over. It took me a very, very long time. Just using standard carburetor cleaner. Now you can get one of those buckets that have the gunk inside of it. It's like a 5-gallon pail, or I think you can get it even in like a 2-gallon pail or something like that. You can do a, you know, it's one of those carburetor soak pails. Those work just as good. I used to use those, but those are getting harder to find. They might sell them at Napa, I'm not sure, but I just went ahead and just used the good old spray, and then the different types of brushes, just to get it all nice and clean. So got everything all clean, everything all laid out on the table, and I'm ready to start putting this thing back together. So a couple of things to note. These carburetor kits come with a bag of assorted parts, seals, plastic pieces, things like that. Now you're not going to use everything that they give you, so don't start looking for things to replace because you won't find it. So some kits, here's the accelerator pump, here's the original one, here's the new one. You can see the new one does not have the spring or the retainer clip on it. And you can see that ridge right there. Basically all you do is you pull that spring down, and that releases the tension on the retainer clip. Just kind of slide it out. It has a slot right there, and it slips out of the slot on the rod here, and then you just move it over to the new one. So I'll show you how to do that. It's real easy to do. Next thing, these rubber seals here, you get three of them. I'm not sure why you get three of them. Like I said, these kits are probably universal for the most part, but those rubber seals, one of them goes right here. This is where the choke housing goes, and the choke, there's a rod that goes through there. So you just basically pick that out of there and choose one of these new ones and drop it in just like so. There you go, new seal right there. Then you got another plastic piece right here. And then you got the new one. That plastic piece went inside of that hole right there. So that's another thing you got to replace. So just grab the new one and put it in the hole right there. Just like that. Finally, this is a plastic gasket or a washer that goes on the fuel filter housing right there. There's a ridge on this fuel filter, and the old gasket just pulls right off, and the new gasket just, it snaps into place. You'll have to work it around and get it snapped into that groove. But those are the couple things you've got to keep in mind. And then here is the little check ball, that ball bearing that I showed you that went inside the main carburetor housing. Drops right inside that hole right there. And then it had that funny looking screw. Here it is. That funny looking screw that goes over top of it. So I'm gonna go ahead and start putting this thing back together. Here, I'm gonna go ahead and replace the accelerator pump. Like I said, pull the spring down, get the tension off the retainer clip, and it simply just literally falls out of place. You grab the original spring, put it back on, pull the spring down, hold it down with one hand, grab the new clip. There you go. It just slips on just like that. Get the new washer slipped over top of the filter housing. If your kit comes with multiple different style gaskets, make sure you choose the right one. Make sure you're matching it up with the old original gasket. So yeah, just make sure you have all the proper holes, and make sure it's on the right direction. These gaskets pretty much only go in one direction. Make sure all your gasket surfaces are good and clean. Remember, the Phillips screws hold on the bottom part. Make sure you snug these things down pretty good, because over time, if they're not tight, they will work themselves loose. All right. The bottom part is back on. Now I did already clean and install the two idle mixture screws, and I did run them all the way down until they stopped,
gently snugged them, very, very gently, just till they bottomed out, and then backed each one of them out 4.5 turns, and that's usually a good starting point on where to leave these screws. All right, also make sure you're putting all the rods and things back in it the way they came apart, because some of these rods and the linkages and carb linkages and things like that, if they're not put together in the proper order, it might be hard to get them back together on it, or together once the carburetor is together. So there's a piece, a choke plate that goes in here, which is choke plate that goes right in here. That is this piece right here. And this piece will sit inside of here, but you cannot, you have to put this piece in at the same time you put the choke on itself, because this right here fits through that little flat plate. So it all kind of goes together at the same time together. So just little things to keep in mind. Now I did go ahead and install the jets, and I also installed the check ball and the screw as well. All right, now I'm gonna go ahead and assemble the float. Now I am gonna use the original float just because there's nothing wrong with it. It's not cracked, it's not deteriorated. So there's really nothing wrong with it. So it cleaned up okay, so I'm just gonna go ahead and reuse it. Now, the kit comes with a new needle, seat, and washer. And then here is the original one. Now, you can see that there are some differences between the new seat and the old seat. There's a slot right there, but it's all gonna work out the same. Not a big deal. So when you do pull out the original seat, which sits right here, this gasket right here tends to get itself stuck. It's like a metal washer. It tends to get itself stuck down in there. So what you want to do is gently get yourself a pick tool and you know, gently get down inside there and find the edge and lift it up, because you definitely don't want to, you know, put the old one and new one on top of each other, because that's going to mess everything up. The seat's going to be sitting higher, the float's not going to sit right. Just that little tiny metal washer will mess things all up. So you can see right here, the original needle has that little hanger on it, and then the kit comes with the new hanger, and you have to snap the hanger onto the new needle just like that. So I'm gonna go ahead, get the hanger on the needle, get the float inside, and show you guys how to check the adjustment level on the float. Make sure you are using a very large flathead screwdriver to screw down the seat. Just because the seat is so wide, you want to make sure you got a screwdriver that fits it. And it just threads into place. I already got the float sitting in there, and I'm ready to go ahead and check the adjustment on it. Now, do keep in mind, I did mention that I'm using the original float, so the adjustment should be correct. But I'm just going to double check it just in case. And I do have the instruction sheet sitting here. And I did have to grab my sheet from one of my past rebuilds, just because the pamphlets and the sheets that came with the kit do not show this right here. This is the little notation that tells about how to put the float hanger in the arm. Do not put it through the hole. Just basically says hook the clip over the edge of flat on the float arm, meaning the flat portion of the float arm. Just don't hook it through the hole. Just hook it from the inside and around. Really not that difficult. Just pay attention to how it came apart, pending the previous person put it together correctly. So isn't all that difficult. Just don't hook it through the hole. I don't know how many times I got to tell you guys, but it's gonna mess it up if you go ahead and do it that way. So here's a little diagram on how to adjust the float. I'll show you that in a second. Within these instructions, they do give guidelines on setting for the float, and you follow it down to your carburetor. This is a 1979 1705-9207. This one says 211 is circled, but that's from my last rebuild. One of my last rebuilds, this is a 207, so that falls into this category, and it says 15/32 of an inch. And these kits come with a little measuring ruler here, 1/32. Each one of these little lines is 1/32. It said 15/32, so I'm gonna go ahead and count 15 of those lines, There's 12 and then there's 16, so it's gonna be one down from 16. So I'm gonna set the camera down. All right, now in order to check the depth or the measurement on this float, you're gonna take two fingers. First one's gonna hold down the, basically the arm with a little hold down. The other one's gonna gently push the float until the needle bottoms out. And then you take the ruler and lightly set it on the toe of the float. And then you measure from the top of the carburetor. And this may not show up on camera, but it is looking at exactly 15-30 seconds. So that's how you do it. You measure, you hold the float down just so the needle is seating in there. Set the ruler on the very toe of the float, and then you measure to the top of the carburetor, double checking that is 15-30 seconds, and that's how you adjust the float. Oh, and if you do actually need to adjust the float, you go ahead and pull it out and you bend the arm of the float slightly up or down. So to adjust the float, you simply bend the arm right here. See this upside down V? That is the pivot point. So you just bend it by holding the float right here and then just bend this up or down. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and put the choke on. Now when putting the choke on, you don't just screw this back on and you're done. Basically, there are a couple key things to keep in mind here. You have this piece right here. Now this is the little rocker that prevents the secondaries from opening when the engine's cold. And I'll show you how that goes in a second. Then you also have another piece that fits down inside the carburetor, fits down right here. Now this is gonna be probably one of the hardest parts of putting this thing back together, because this fits down inside of here as you're putting the choke back on the side of it like that, because you can see that this piece right here has a flat spot in it, and so does this right here. So that fits over that and it kind of locks into place, because on the other side, the other end of this piece with the holes in it, there's a rod that goes through that, that goes up through the air horn, and that rod controls the choke flap on the top. So this all kind of interlocks into place. So it's almost like a puzzle. You're dropping this down inside of here, and you're also putting the choke housing on the side of the carburetor. So it is a little bit time consuming, a little bit of a pain in the ass, but that's how it goes back together. And then you also have to keep in mind, like I said, is this little rocker piece right here. And you had to pay attention how it came apart, take pictures if you needed to, but it fits right here. See this little ridge? This ridge on the top, that faces up, and it fits on that arm right there, and it rests against this tab for the secondaries. So just pay attention how that all comes apart, and then we'll go ahead and put on the choke housing itself. Now one trick I'm going to do is I'm going to actually use a magnet and guide this down into this hole, and you'll be able to look through the hole on the side of the carburetor as you put this piece down here. And once you see the piece come through the hole, then you'll be able to line everything up visually, at least the best you can. There we go, in place. And then you go ahead and put the screw inside. Okay, so once you have the float all completely adjusted, you just start putting things back together the way they came apart. You have to drop in the little cover for the float, and then the little cup, which doesn't do anything. Drop that back into place. And then you have the couple of springs that come out of here. You have the power valve spring that drops into place, and then also the accelerator pump spring. Just kind of push that into place and it kind of stays put in there. All right, well, I guess I'll grab the gasket for the air horn. Now, when I mentioned before that these carburetors come with several different gaskets, you have, of course, the air cleaner gasket. You have the base plate gasket that goes in between the carburetor and the intake manifold. Then you have the gasket that went from the base of the carburetor to the center of the carburetor, which I already installed. And then you have a couple different air horn gaskets. Now, these kits do come with two different air horn gaskets. So like I said before, just match it up with your original gasket, the one that you set aside. So I have the original one right here. You can see this air horn gasket has these weird tabs right here. And that is definitely different. So we'll set that one aside. And then this one right here is going to be the one you use. So just make sure you match them up. Just put them over top of each other. Make sure all the holes line up. And this one does. So this is the one I'm going to use. And make sure the surface is all nice and clean. Set that in place. Now, something I just thought of. Before you set that into place, this gasket has a few tears in it, or a few slits, and you can see that right there. These slits bend around the power valve, and that's something also that's a little bit difficult to do. You gotta make sure you don't tear the gasket itself. You kinda work it around the power valve itself. So when you pull it apart, when I pulled that apart, you saw how the gasket, when I pulled the carburetor apart for the first time, the air horn, this power valve was sticking through this gasket, so it kind of fits around it. So just be very, very careful when putting that in place. So I'm going to go ahead and put the power valve in place. Oh, I did mention, let me grab the camera. I did mention the power valve screw, the set screw. Now, this is not a needle screw that adjusts any type of jet. This is a set screw that adjusts the height of the valve that bounces up and down in there. Like I showed you before, the little tab sets on the flat part of that screw. Now the setting of this screw, if someone did mess with this, it is four turns out once bottomed out. So if you got yourself the special tool, or you can carefully use a pair of pliers, if this screw has been messed with, you run it all the way down until it stops and then back it out four turns. Okay, now this is something actually pretty difficult to do. You want to make sure you put it in correctly, of course. And not, like I said, these two needles sit down inside through these two holes. And since this cover goes over top the float, it makes it very, very difficult to get this to sit in here properly and get the needles to sit into place. So don't get frustrated. Take your time. Do not bend those needles. If you end up bending those needles, you're going to be in a world of hurt. So kind of drop it in there and then feel around if you can. Get yourself a light, which I don't have, and get those needles to sit down inside of those jets, which they just did. So go ahead, and once they sit down in there, hold it down, because this, let me find my screwdriver, my little pointer here, this little washer, let me grab the camera, set it down here if I can. Here we go, much better. So the power valve is sitting down in there. You hold it down once those needles are in those jets. And then this little washer thing, this is basically a little retaining washer. Push it down inside the carburetor itself. You gotta work it around with the screwdriver. Just press it down inside the carburetor housing. There, just kind of fits in place. Work it around. I'll use two of them here. Kind of work it back and forth. Push down, make sure it's seated. And there, it sits in place. Make sure it goes up and down properly. Make sure it doesn't bind, because that thing just moves up and down as you got your foot on or off the gas. Once that is in place, you grab the gasket. Make sure you put it on correctly. Fit it around the holes that the gasket sets in, the pins on the carburetor. All right, now you can see the gasket sitting on top of that power valve. I did note those slits So basically, you lift up the gasket, carefully bend the gasket, and work it around that power piston very, very carefully. Okay. All right. There you go. Gasket is gently worked around the valve. Still moves up and down. And then you can see how it sits around there like that. Okay, a couple other things to keep in mind once getting this gasket in place around the power valve right there and putting the air horn on. I'm gonna have to put the accelerator pump in here, which is spring loaded. So that thing's gonna constantly be fighting this gasket. And then also the choke arm that hooks around that piece down in there, you would have to have that setting just like that, because that is what comes up through the air horn and hooks to the choke plate itself. So make sure you hook this into place. I've put the whole carburetor together and forgot to hook this into place. You have to take it all back apart because it's pretty difficult to get this thing in place once the air horn's on. I'm sure it might be possible, but you're just better off trying to get it on there before that. So let me get this thing hooked into place, get the accelerator pump into place, and then I'll get the air horn on and show you guys kind of how it all comes together. You have to hold everything into place, kind of fish this rod through the air horn, just fish everything into place. Just take your time and carefully get it together. Okay, I got the choke rod sitting in here. I have the accelerator pump in here as well. Fit it down in the spring. You might want to put a little dab of oil or WD-40 on the accelerator pump rubber, just so when it fits down inside of here, it moves nicely up and down in the carburetor itself. So push it down, feed the gasket over it, make sure it's functioning properly. Hold it down with your finger. All right, now, of course, make sure you have everything put together down inside the carburetor itself. You're not forgetting anything. Make sure you don't have any parts laying around that you might forget or that you may have forgotten. Now, time to put the air horn on. All right, feed it over the choke rod. Then keep in mind you have all those tubes that stick down on the air horn. Those have to be fed through all the proper holes. Feed it down over top the accelerator pump. There's a choke rod getting in the way. Gotta feed that down, it's like a puzzle. Once everything gets fed down properly, the air horn will sit perfectly flat. There we go. Everything's sitting nice and flat. Looks like everything is in place. So now what I'm gonna do next is start assembling or putting all the screws in place. Just double check that you have everything sitting flat, because you don't want to over tighten anything. If this air horn is not sitting flat for some reason, you might tweak it or anything like that. So, all right, I'm going to go ahead and start putting the screws in. All right, guys, we are getting there. Almost done. So I have all the air horn screws tightened down. Started from the middle and worked my way out on the outside. I tightened them pretty tight. You definitely don't want to crank them down as hard as you can, but you do want to make them pretty tight. Next thing to do is feed the secondary metering rods into the holes. And if fed down correctly, they don't fall off the little hanger here. They will sit in there. They'll drop right into place. All right, they drop down inside of there. Once they drop down inside, put the screw into place. And when you tighten this screw, just snug it down. You do not have to tighten this very hard at all, because if you tighten it too hard, you'll break off the head of the screw, because those threads are very, very small. Okay, next thing to do, is put on the accelerator pump arm. This is the rod that goes down to the throttle linkage. And then put it back in the proper hole. You can see the hole where it was, just the wear marks. Hook it into place, set the arm into place, line up the holes. And then I did mention that the roll pin was still in there before. So you basically take your screwdriver in between the body of the carburetor and the roll pin and work the roll pin back into place. All right, get the new gasket for the choke housing, put that on, and make sure you hook the spring of the choke, has the hook on it, and make sure you hook it to the proper spot around the choke housing on the arm on the inside. Okay, one of the very last things I had to do is put the choke pull-off on. And before you do that, you want to make sure the choke pull-off is in good shape. In order to find that out, basically all you do is just a vacuum diaphragm. Here's the vacuum line. Make sure your vacuum line's good. Push the diaphragm all the way down until it stops. Put your finger over the hole, and if it pops back up, you know it's bad. If it doesn't, then you know it's good. And this one is in good shape because I'm holding my finger over the hole. It's not coming up. You let your finger out from the hole, and it releases. So this choke pull-off is in good shape, so I'm going to go ahead and put it back on the carburetor. All right, put the wing nut stud back on it. Tighten that down. Make sure you got yourself a new fuel filter. And this does only fit in here one way. See, it does not go in that way. It goes in that way. Make sure you got the spring on the back side of it. Just fits inside there like that. Screw on the fitting. Get your gasket. Make sure you don't have any other parts left over. Everything looks good. All right, guys, well, there you have it. Stick that wing nut on there. And there you go. Carburetor is freshly rebuilt, all nice and clean. Everything's tightened down. It was quite a project. If you guys are doing this for the first time, definitely go back and watch this video a couple different times. I know it was long, but I couldn't have done it any other way. Before you take apart a carburetor, if this is your first time doing it, make sure you take a lot of pictures. That'll be a huge help. It'll kind of help you out on when things or how things go back together. But we are looking good, looking clean, everything functions properly, and we are ready to put it back on the 79 Malibu sitting right here. So you guys will have to wait till the next time I'll get this carburetor on the car, and we'll go ahead and fire it up. So make sure you're subscribing, leaving comments, asking questions, and of course I will do my best to always answer all the questions that you guys have. All right, guys, until the next time, I will talk to you in the next Classic G-Body Garage video.